Psalm 146. And you could object that even if it is true that they pass, meanwhile they can cause much suffering, or they can benefit so many people in the process. And it is true, this is true, especially of this country. But even so, no one defeats God. He is powerful. He knows more. He can bring good things out of every human affair, especially for those who trust in him, especially for the church. While we do our best to add our own grain of sand, Jesus said himself, "When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for such things must happen first, but it will not immediately be the end." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be powerful earthquakes, famines, and plagues from place to place, and awesome sights and mighty signs will come from the sky." All these things will happen, but keep your peace, says the Lord. God is God. God is God. Tonight, I would like to invite you, if you are in the side of the winning party, to be magnanimous, to understand the fears and concerns of those who are in the opposite side. Yes, you have the right to be happy about this election if you want, but as a believer, you should moderate that feeling, lest you put too much hope in a mere man or in a mere party. If you are on the side of the ones who lost, be confident. Moderate your sadness or fear. God is God, and nothing escapes his providence. St. Paul says to the Corinthians, "Let those having wives act as not having them, those weeping as not weeping, those rejoicing as not rejoicing, those buying as not owning, those using the world as not using it fully. For the world in its present form is passing away. I should like you to be free of anxieties." 1 Corinthians 7. So let's moderate our feelings. Let's put them into perspective. Let's remember who we are, where we are going, what is our destiny and our call. And this is very important. Let not these divisions enter into the church. C.S. Lewis wrote in 1948 a letter to Don Calabria, an Italian priest that worked in those days in Verona. He ran an orphanage. And the priest was complaining on the social situation of the post-war in Italy. In that letter, Lewis advises that the priest to be at peace and to mind his own business, to do what he can, and to avoid worrying too much. And this is what he says. I will read now from C.S. Lewis' letter. "I believe that the men of this age, and among them you, Father, and myself, think too much about the state of nations and the situation of the world. Does not the author of the Imitation warn us against involving ourselves too much with such things? We are not kings. We are not senators. Let us beware lest, while we torture ourselves in vain about the state of Europe, we neglect either Verona or Oxford. In the poor man who knocks at my door, in my ailing mother, in the young man who seeks my advice, the Lord himself is present. Therefore, let us wash his feet." I think that this is the attitude to cultivate today for us. We are normal men and women, students at Oregon State University, that cannot do much about politics, besides voting, obviously. If you won, congratulations. If you lost, cheer up. And now that things are decided, at least for the next 4 years, let us go back to our occupations. Let us seek the Lord. Let us love the ones around us, and God will be with us. Finish of my old homily. Postscript of today. I would add, just to wrap it up, if we are Catholic, as Catholics, of course we are Catholics, as Catholics, as Christians, given the result of the election, we need to commit more deeply to the pro-life cause, protecting the life of the unborn and the holiness of the human family. Because if we read the signs of the time, it is clear that that topic is not as important for many people in this country. If Trump has won, I would have said we need to commit with the poor and of the healing of divisions and work for a more kingdom-like society, but he didn't. So I think now we have to ponder that situation and recommit with that that is very dear and close to the heart of the church and to the heart of God, the life of the unborn and the holiness, sacredness, and beauty of family life. Let us witness us. Let us commit with that. Do what we can. And let us not worry too much. You know, the church is a real agent of the kingdom. The church is the only one who can really, I mean, it's God through the church, who can really touch hearts and minds and change the culture. So just let's do our part in that mission to be salt of the earth and light of the world. Let us be at peace. And now this is a great response to what I just said. If you're happy about this election, if you're sad about this election, same response. Let us pray with the creed, with what we believe. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us now confidently raise our hearts and voices in prayer to our Heavenly Father, the living God.
For Pope Francis, Archbishop Gregory, for all bishops, priests, and deacons, and for all ministers of our church, that they may persevere in their proclamation of God's justice and peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our church and parish community, that we may respond to Christ's call to discipleship through the giving of our treasure, time, and talents to our many parish ministries, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of our parishioners who are ill or recovering, for all who are imprisoned, abused, or suffering in any way, that they may be delivered from every evil, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died in the peace of Christ, whom we honor this month of November, that the God of the living may restore them to life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God will hear the prayers we now make in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, listen to all these prayers and bring your peace to our hearts through Christ our Lord.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours might be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice for the grace of your Lord, for our good.
Look with favor, we pray, O Lord, upon the sacrificial gifts offered here, that celebrating in mystery the passion of your Son, we may honor it with loving devotion. Through Christ, our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending debt. And by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end. We acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Wilton, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, pray for Concha Katama. And to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. to have peace, we have to zoom out to God, raise our eyes to heaven, and also to look ahead. That gives us a wise perspective. And that works for both ways. If you're happy or if you're sad, look up, moderate your feelings. Look ahead, be wise. We are always called to work for the kingdom in every circumstance. God is with us. Let us pray the prayer that the Lord taught us, because he wanted to teach us to ask for what we really need every day. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say,
The disciples recognize the Lord Jesus in the breaking of bread. Yes, Lord, you are my God. I thank you and I praise you for this Holy Mass, for your Eucharistic presence in our midst, for feeding us with your word, with your body. Lord, everything is in your hand, and we are called to love and to serve and to surrender in every circumstance, when we win and when we lose, when things turn out as we hope for and when they don't. Lord, you are the King of history. Your plan is fulfilled in any way. Help us, Lord, to raise our hope today, to moderate our feelings, to be men and women of wisdom, of supernatural sight, not to let the affairs of this world to seize completely our heart, to take hold of our heart too much, lest we might be tempted to put our fears or our hopes in princes, men that cannot save. You are the only one, Lord, that can touch minds and hearts. We pray for your church today. Help us to be faithful to carry on the mission of preaching the kingdom to everyone. Lord, you wanted your church to be a sign of unity. You said, let them be one, Father, so that the world can believe. Help us to stay united. What we have from you is so much more important than any circumstances that comes and goes like the waves of the ocean. Lord, help us not to be moved too much by the ebbs and flows of circumstances, but to cling to you and to do our best, and give us your peace.
Jesus.
Let us pray. Nourished by this sacred gift, O Lord, we give you thanks and beseech your mercy, that by the pouring forth of your Spirit, the grace of integrity may endure in those your heavenly power has entered. Through Christ our Lord. Today we have a second collection. It's a mandatory second collection by the USCCB for the retired priest. So you have the brochures there. So as we proceed to do that second collection, Paige will give us some announcements and we can take a seat.
Good evening, everyone. I just have one announcement for you tonight, and that's that this Tuesday at 7:30 p.m., AU Catholic will be hosting an online discussion on involving God in your decision-making. I think it's going to be pretty cool. We're going to be having it over Zoom, and so if you're interested, you can register at aucatholicdc.org/openness. Thank you.
Too bad that we don't have more announcements. When you don't want them, you have them. When you need them, there's only one. But Paige did a very good job. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.